Welcome. The early portion of this class focuses on learning about the financial statements and what's included on them. So I wanted to start this presentation by discussing a little bit about the four major financial statements, starting with the balance sheet. The balance sheet, you'll see several different definitions for a balance sheet, but I always like the definition that it just represents essentially a snapshot of a company's financial position at a particular point in time. Think of it as if you were taking a picture at the close of business, say at the end of the month or the end of the year, and you want to look at a company's financial position at that point in time, kind of like freezing time at that moment and just seeing where the financial position of the company is. That's what a balance sheet really does. When you look at a balance sheet, it really has three major components, and this is what comprises what we call the financial position of the company: assets, liabilities, and stockholders' equity. So let's talk about each one of these and make sure we have a good understanding of what they mean. First, assets. Again, you'll see different definitions for assets. I like this one. Assets represent economic resources. They have the ability or potential to provide a future benefit to a company. So when you think of assets, several things come to mind. The first one being cash. Cash would definitely be an economic resource that has a future benefit because you can use it to buy inventory, supplies, pay your employees, and so forth. Definitely it would fit under the definition of an asset. Other things like buildings, equipment, machinery, automobiles, even airplanes, inventory, all of these would be assets. Also, there's some other assets you may not think about right off the bat, but you will run across here in the first couple of chapters, one of them being accounts receivable. Accounts receivable are amounts that are owed to you from your customers, and they actually represent an asset as well because they're an economic resource and they have the future benefit. The future benefit being that the customer is slated to pay you at some point in the future. So all those would be what we consider to be assets. Liabilities are a little easier to understand. They're obligations or debts that a company must pay at some point in the future. They come in a couple of different forms. There are what we call short-term liabilities, things like accounts payable, which is the opposite of accounts receivable. Those are things, accounts payable typically encompasses short-term amounts that you have to pay here in the next couple of weeks, like maybe rent or a lease payment, something along those lines. And then sometimes longer-term liabilities, like maybe a note payable with a bank or a mortgage note or something along those lines. So liabilities are debts. The third category, stockholders' equity, is probably the hardest one for people to understand. Here's a definition. Stockholders' equity represents the owner's claims on the assets of a company. In order to understand stockholders' equity, you really need to understand the basic accounting equation. And this is one of the major topics here early on. You will need to know this equation: assets equals liabilities plus stockholders' equity. You can see all three components listed here just in equation form. This is kind of a tough equation to understand when you first look at it, because it may not just intuitively make sense that assets equals liabilities plus stockholders' equity. But when you look at this accounting equation, one thing just to keep in mind, and probably one of the most critical components of this, is that every time you record a transaction, this accounting equation must hold true after recording that transaction. So for instance, if you impact one side of the equation, you will need to impact the other side. You can see here in this example, if we have assets of 1,000, we must also then have liabilities and stockholders' equity equal to the same amount. Now, intuitively, like I said, looking at this equation, sometimes it's not as easy to figure out. But if you do some simple math on this equation and just change a few of the components around, in other words, what if we were to move the liabilities to the other side or the right side of the equation, you'd have to subtract it from the assets. You essentially still have the same exact equation here mathematically, but it may make a little more sense. Because if you think about it, if assets are economic resources that have a future benefit, or in other words, things that you own, like buildings, cars, cash, things like that, and liabilities are debts or things that you owe, well, logically, if you think about it this way, if assets, say you have $1,000 of assets, things you own, and you have debt against those assets of, say, $300, amounts that you owe against those balances, what you're left with is stockholders' equity of $700. And you can start to begin to get a picture of what stockholders' equity is all about. Some people like to think of stockholders' equity as kind of like net worth. If you were to think about your personal assets and your personal liabilities, if you take what you own minus what you owe, what you're left with is your net worth. And that's somewhat like what stockholders' equity functions like in an accounting system. All right, so that's the balance sheet. Let's talk about the income statement. The income statement illustrates the net income or earnings of a company for a period of time. A very different statement here. A period of time meaning we prepare an income statement for, say, a month, maybe a quarter, or maybe just at the year end. But it's for a period of time. When you typically see an income statement on the title, you'll see it say the time frame that the statement encompasses. So for instance, in this case, you can see here it's for the year ended December 31st, so for the whole 12 months, January through December. And the components on the income statement include revenues, expenses, and then when you subtract expenses from revenues, you'll get a calculation for something we call net income. Now, of course, if your expenses were in excess of your revenues, you'd have a net loss. What you're looking at here is a very simplified income statement. We would usually list out maybe a couple of different revenue categories, and we would most certainly list out several expense categories to give us a little more detail. But in general, these two totals subtract from each other to arrive at a net income figure. So let's talk about these components. Revenues. Revenues are measured by the assets received in exchange for goods or services rendered. The thing to remember about revenues is that when we look at a business, revenues really are things or activities that we do in terms of services or products that we sell in the what we call normal course of business. So not everything is categorized as revenue. So for instance, if you went out, for instance, and sold an automobile that you owned in the business for $5,000, that wouldn't necessarily be categorized as revenue because you may not be in the business of necessarily selling automobiles. We have other ways to track that, and we'll talk about some of those ways later in the course. But revenue would be in the typical format of selling a product or selling a service or what you normally do in kind of your everyday business activities. Expenses are the costs incurred by a company in the process of earning revenue. These two are related. In other words, you would only incur an expense in a company in the process of actually earning revenue for that company. So they're connected. An example would be if you went out and say, bought some web advertising or an ad in a catalog, these expenses would be in the process of earning revenue. Likewise, if you hired a salesperson or even an accountant or a human resources employee in your business, all of these costs would be in the process, hopefully, of earning revenue for your business. So these two are related, and of course you would not spend the money if it weren't somehow or another either directly or indirectly in the process of earning revenue. So that's how we define expenses. One of the things that you'll hear early on, and maybe one of the more critical concepts to try to understand, is something called the matching concept, and it goes along a little bit with what I was just talking about. Accrual accounting principles are designed to match expenses with revenues in the same reporting period. So what we're looking for with the matching concept is to make sure that that the expenses that we incur, say, in one month, say October, are matched with the revenues that are earned as a result of those expenses also in October. Now, it doesn't always work out perfectly as described, but the way we book entries, and you'll see this as we kind of move along in the course, are designed to try to get to the best possible scenario, try to get these expenses matched up with these revenues in the same accounting period. So a lot of what we do, even the strange things that you'll see we'll do as we move on here in the next couple of chapters, are really geared and designed around the matching concept.